Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Learning Continuum series, Built in Community Through Narrative Arts. I'd like to hand things over to Lorraine Carter, the Director of McMaster Continuing Education.
Good evening and welcome, everyone. It's great to have you with us this evening. This is the first of our new series called The Learning Continuum. The idea being, of course, that there is a journey to this process of learning. Some of it is that which happens in a formal capacity. Other times it's learning from each other. And this evening we have the terrific opportunity to bring to you two individuals who will tell you about some great work happening in our region. I'd also, though, before we get to the panel presentation, if you will, like to introduce colleagues from McMaster, Drs. Daniel Coleman and Lorraine York. They are both with the Faculty of Humanities, and in particular, the Department of English and Cultural Studies. So at this particular point, I'm going to pass things to Daniel to tell us a little bit about the work of an organization called CENA, which is the Center for Community Engaged Narrative Arts, and set the stage for this evening, Daniel.
Hi, everybody. It's a real pleasure to be here at this series and to be able to talk about the work that CENA does. We say CENA to refer to the acronym of the Center for Community Engaged Narrative Arts. Our understanding is that stories make communities and communities make stories, and that those two activities are mutually constitutive. They make each other. You know, for a community to form, its members need to feel a sense of shared story that narrates what they have in common, whether that's a story of common place of origin, a common set of challenges or suffering, or common future purpose. And we're aware as we begin an evening like this that we meet on the territories of people who have held stories in this region for a long time, Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe people here at the head of the lake. And we're privileged to be in the story that descends from their having been in this place and the many stories of people who live in this region. You know, community stories can be ways of affirming existing relations, but they can also, so they can be official stories, but they can also be contestatory stories. And we know that there are stories in our region that are about seeking redress and justice or seeking to be heard. And CENA, McMaster's Center for Community Engaged Narrative Arts, is interested in supporting and enhancing community-based storytelling, or maybe I should say art-based community making. You know, you can say these things both ways. We've over the past 5 years had the privilege of working with over now 30 different community-based storytelling projects. And CENA is co-directed by my good friend and colleague, Lorraine York, who is on the screen here tonight, and myself. As Lorraine Carter said, we're both members of the Department of English and Cultural Studies at McMaster. And we've been really lucky to be supported and enabled by the work of some wonderful and amazing student researchers, graduate student researchers over the years. And tonight we're delighted to have the support of Catherine Waring, who's a PhD student in the Department of Communication Studies and New Media Studies, and who has worked in the area of community-based storytelling and story-making art in Pennsylvania and has now moved to McMaster to do that work with us here. So at this point, I'll turn things over to my friend and colleague, Lorraine York, to introduce our speakers for this evening.
It's my very great pleasure to do so. These are two people who have been very close to our hearts at CENA, and two people who have given so immensely to many, many communities. So I will introduce both of them and then turn it over. Michelle Peak, first of all, is a community engaged educator and photographer. She's interested in the transformative role of art in community-based social justice projects and mental well-being. She has a keen interest in issues of embodiment and representation, human rights, and what it means to exist in a complicated global landscape. Michelle holds a PhD, we're very proud to say, in English and Cultural Studies from McMaster University, where she studied love and belonging in contemporary queer, Indigenous, and human rights literature. She currently resides in Guelph, where she's a portrait and documentary style photographer and founder and creative director of the nonprofit organization Art Not Shame. Shane Neilson is a poet, physician, literary critic, and scholar of Canadian literatures who lives with disability. When I was looking through the various online biographies of Shane, and there are quite a few, I think my favorite sentence was this one. He published his first literary review in 1998 and has had to look over his shoulder ever since. In 2012, his critical prose won an ARC Poetry Magazine's Critics Desk Award. In 2018, his scholarly work on Canadian literature that is rooted in disability studies was awarded SHRC's prestigious Talent Award. And like Michelle, we are once again proud to say he is a PhD graduand of McMaster's Department of English and Cultural Studies. Shane's poetry has received many accolades, including the Hamilton Literary Award for Poetry in 2018 and the Walrus Poetry Prize in 2017. Shane is an adjunct assistant professor in family medicine at McMaster University, and he continues to practice medicine in Guelph.
So I'm here today to talk about Hamilton Arts and Letters magazine and how it cares for Hamilton, both the amount of care it provides and the means of the provision of that care are access to my time. It's usually the way, you know, but I think that's a good thing. With just a few items sketched in, you can then engage with the magazine itself. This talk will provide you with some basic details about the magazine, and then it'll then focus on some specific instances of Hamilton Arts and Letters provision of care, and it will conclude with an invitation to subscribe to the magazine. Of course, we'd love to have you. So the origin story, Hamilton Arts and Letters began, meaning it published its first issue around 2008. The editorial team at that time was Fiona Kinsella, Paul Lasson, and Peter Stevens. And that's changed over the years, although Fiona and Paul are the stalwarts. And my role since 2015 is to cobble book reviews together, which is interesting because that's how my bio started. Didn't anticipate that. Each issue of Hamilton Arts and Letters is a thematically rendered, such that the writing largely, though not exclusively, coheres around a theme. The magazine's uncommonly beautiful, and this talk provides visuals to prove the point. And that beauty is attributable to the artistic vision and design skills of Fiona. Hamilton Arts and Letters is driven by text and visuals, but there are other kinds of media like original song compositions, videos, and perhaps my favorite, digital poetry chapbooks. The vision of the magazine is simple: to publish the best materials it can, both from within the city of Hamilton and without. And notable names, I don't want to name drop, but I do, you know, as published over the years, include Dennis Lee, Bruce Elder, and Kenneth McRobbie. But the list is long, you know. Okay, so how does the magazine care for its people and who are its people? Well, I'm going to ask you a question, since I'm not really sure myself. Do you know of another literary magazine in Canada that cares for its home city as much as this one? I think I'm a pretty good authority. You know, I'm aware of most of them, this being something I'm supposed to know as a writer, editor, and publisher. I could name a handful of exemplary magazines that attempt to create community, but their efforts are always diffused by the lure of the national. Hamilton Arts and Letters thinks both Hamilton and beyond at the same time. Indeed, it's so uncommon. Let me tell you the moment when I realized that the magazine was special, because I didn't always know that it was so special. In 2016, I walked into the Hamilton room at the Hamilton Public Library with my wife, Janet. The room was packed with people for the occasion of the launch of Hamilton Arts and Letters issue 9.2, which was dedicated to and organized around Hamilton artist couple Cees and Enery Van Gimmerden. So far, I was thinking that this was a pretty impressively attended magazine launch. Nothing more than that. You know, I've been to a lot of fancy Toronto magazine launches after all. But at this point at my time in the magazine, I've been around for about a year. I had scrounged up a few pieces for the magazine, and I was organizing a future themed issue around illness. I liked Hamilton Arts and Letters, but I didn't really know it yet. I didn't love it yet. You can see visually the the cease and enter issue. What transpired, though, offered me a spiritual experience. I witnessed community members and academics attest to the artistic prowess and civic responsibilities of cease and enter, offering testimonials and accounts that felt like an oral history of Hamilton itself, as embodied and emblematized by cease and enter. The kind of authenticity on offer is uncommon in Canadian literature, platforms, and venues. I fell in love with the kind of magazine that could do this, that could make a city reflect on itself, its past, its art, its failures. Opposing Red Hill Parkway was failure, and its necessary resistances. So here's a partial history of care by Hamilton Arts and Letters, at least as I know it. It's very partial, and, you know, it's my vector, which is what I can speak to. So one day I asked Paul and Fiona if I could edit an issue focused on illness with a special emphasis on mental illness, and they said yes. So issue 10.1 back in 2017 became an issue in which we published material from across North America, but to be honest, I'm most proud of an interview with a Mad Hamilton poet and their poem and a review of their work, and also the visual artifacts provided by Fiona that came from the old Hamilton Sanatorium. The issue suggests that it's the stories of our individual and collective suffering that make ourselves known to one another. I mean, success is too, but we're prone to talk about those a lot more. Sometime later, I asked Paul and Fiona if I could edit an issue focused on, of all places, my home province of New Brunswick. They said yes, and issue 11.3, published in 2018, became this. See how beautiful it is? It's just so beautiful. So we published material sourced within the province, but as usual, we had a close eye on Hamilton at the same time. So we're very attentive to the Hamilton diaspora. Thus, we published a review, interview, and poems by Hamilton-born and McMaster-educated poet and dramatist Robert Moore. The issue literally cares for the poetry of New Brunswick, but there's something community-extending, for lack of a better term, when a magazine tracks its hometown children, minding them somehow and featuring them when the time's right. Not long after that, we published issue 12.2 in 2020 on disability. And it's quite special. I mean, all of them are special, but this one's quite special to me because it's the very first Canadian poetry anthology focusing on both invisible and visible disabilities. It creates the kind of community that heretofore knew of itself only partially and then mostly on social media. I've corresponded with academics in the United States and the UK about this issue, and they've ordered books from there. Again, Hamilton figures prominently in that issue, and the magazine made a great friend in Leo Dragto, poet and performer extraordinaire, and seen as familiar with Leo. So consider, though, the most recent issue. What do you think that's about? I mean, it's all there in the title. Continuity is brought by a contribution from cease and enter. The issue focuses in particular on the imaginative and material manifestations of COVID-19 within the city. If I were to nominate a single piece that demonstrated the care Hamilton offers itself as channeled by its literary avatar, Hamilton Arts and Letters magazine, and I'm about to embarrass them now, but that's all right. I'd select My Life in Pieces by Peggy Ann Mansfield, as told to and organized by Daniel Coleman. I'm going to read to you a little length from the foreword to the piece by Coleman so that you can get a sense of the care work that's being done here. I'm deliberately not looking at Daniel. It'll intimidate me. I was tortured. So that's the beautiful art that leads into it. And here's the text. Read along with me. I was tortured by the people I was raised by, Peggy Ann told me that very first day. It was one of those moments when, as a teacher, you aren't sure how to respond to such a revelation. She went on, I endured everything you can imagine and more. Sexual and physical abuse, being abandoned, living on the streets, being locked up in a psych ward, becoming addicted to the psychotropic drugs I was given, being re-traumatized by therapists and the mental health system that was supposed to help me. That's why I'm terrified to take a class like this. I have a terrible time believing that this will be a safe place, that I can trust you or the others who are organizing this class. But, she added, it really helps that you open the class by asking for our views and opinions. We're so used to being told by people in authority what to think and how to react. It's refreshing to be treated like people with minds of our own, experiences worth sharing. That was my introduction to a woman who would go on to profoundly influence my life. Peggy Ann was courageous, intelligent, a warrior for gentleness and justice. Having been silenced by the crippling codependency of hiding the secrets of domestic abuse since she was 4 years old, she had learned the very hard way to speak freely, even too freely, about what had happened to her. By voicing her dark experiences, she freed herself from the trap of keeping other people's secrets, and she hoped that telling her own story would liberate others from the shame that often kept them from stepping out onto their own paths, their own lives. Her email address was as follows, and she was determined that after suffering in self-doubt and trauma-induced amnesia for so many years, she would speak her truth, and the truth would set her and the people around her free. Each week, the students in the Voice in Hamilton class handed in a reflection piece on what they had read for that week, and I quickly realized Peggy Ann was a gifted writer. I don't know exactly how she got so good at it, since her youth was so unsettled, and she got very little schooling. I suspect it was a combination of a natural gift for words and all the reading she did to understand herself and to investigate her own recovery. Peggy Ann was a person who literally read her way to self-understanding and mental health. Having finally met a therapist who could help her begin to open the door to her own memories when she was in her 40s, she went to the library and read everything she could about domestic abuse, childhood trauma, and their effects on memory and a person's understanding of themselves as a coherent person. Whatever it was that made her such a compelling writer, she had a gift. "You should write your story," I said. "You've got a real ability here, and what you have to say is so important to so many." And that's how it began. Peggy Ann explained that she suffered lapses in attention span. She would write a page or two, she said, but couldn't remember the next day what she had done the day before. And she kept starting over and over at the same place. It was impossible to get any flow. And here's where this beautiful care moment comes along. "Why don't you just send the pieces you write to me?" I suggested. "I'll put them in a file on my computer. And when we get a bunch of pieces saved up, we can sit down sometime and look at what you've got." So that's what we did. Peggy Ann would write a page, two pages, a paragraph, and send it to me as an email attachment. I saved it in my Peggy Ann Mansfield file. Sometimes I read them, but often I simply put them in the file. Sometimes she sent me an email about her writing, about the challenges of writing when her memory was so often interrupted, but how she intended to organize her writing. I saved these two in the Peggy Ann Mansfield file. So that is what ultimately became a posthumously published piece in HA&L, and that was from Daniel Coleman's introduction to it. I don't know of any other magazine that does something like that. And if you want to know more, please look up Hamilton Arts and Letters on the internet. But better yet, we'd love it if you subscribed. And the link to do so is here. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, Shane.
Frankly, I'm still feeling a little bit choked up from that. So I'm going to pass it right on to Michelle.
Okay, good enough.
Thank you, Shane. That was really beautiful. So we are a community arts organization with a social justice heart. And a quick background on how I came to this work is through years of advocacy work for mental health, through my own personal loss with suicide loss, and thinking about, you know, just observing a need for other ways of approaching well-being and mental health, Art Not Shame was born. And I'll say a little bit more about what I mean by that in a moment. So what we do is we use arts to build community, to deepen access to creativity, to increase well-being, and create the conditions for inner and outer change. And part of what that means for us, like our sort of deep purpose, and this sort of follows a somewhat sequential logic, but also a circular logic, is that our deep purpose is to support participants in expressing the creative voice with this deeply held belief that everyone is uniquely creative, to engage in community making through the arts. We live deeply into the idea that the arts give us greater access to ourselves and to each other. And then to sort of recognize that both of those things, creativity and community, are part of what makes us well. And that in that we celebrate and welcome everything, I mean everything, that makes us wonderfully, heartbreakingly human. And then of course, for us, of course, that we can't really do anything without situating all of that within systemic challenges or barriers to learning and self-acceptance and community building, and that the arts might facilitate us learning and unlearning together. So why we do this is, as I said, like having sort of been privy to the biomedical system, the really medicalized way of looking at mental health, I observed even at a really young age, like just this lack of creative or equity-based or community-minded approaches to well-being and mental health. And then knowing that there's a lack of access to the arts, especially those from equity-deserving groups. And then just a whole crap ton of shame in our culture, you know, not being good enough or not being white enough or not being able enough or not being perfect, whatever, like that there are all kinds of ways in which shame is reproduced and then lives out in the body through trauma, through abuse, through relationships. So how we go about, I mean, this is like sort of, these aren't really solutions. These are just sort of ways of exploring these things, but how we do this is by exploring issues of local relevance and building capacities for community care and healing through the arts, and specifically through free art-based workshops. So whether we're looking at perfectionism or COVID isolation or racism or student burnout, like sort of the community defines, and we sort of match the artistic process, and then prioritizing access for equity-seeking groups. And then finally, like, we're not the only ones who can do this, and lots of people do this in lots of beautiful ways. So holding space to learn together and train others to do this work. I'm going to skip over that one just for the sake of time. So that's a little bit about like who we are, who we are, what we do, why we do it, and how we do it. But in this particular talk, I wanted to just focus on this project that we launched last June called the Mural Project, Art in Hard Times, where 67 people came together from marginalized populations to create this massive digital mural reflecting their experiences. And of course, a nod to all of the funders, including Saina, who made that possible. It was a community effort, to say the least. And I have to like just take a moment to acknowledge that Melanie Schombach, this whole project is her brain and heart child. She was the lead artist for this, Colombia and Canada. And she has done like incredible participatory murals across the world. And really believes in the power of these kinds of participatory processes for rethinking identity, belonging, and creating social change. Her website, if you want to check out more of her. How does a participatory mural, so a mural, in other words, a mural that is made by many people and in a way that like sort of honors the process of participating, incorporate listening, witnessing, and storytelling to both create the mural and also to create a form of community care. Witnessing, storytelling, I think, is also quite circular, but so for us, like the very first thing is to embed listening into every part of the design of the project. So, you know, starting with listening, this might sound a bit odd, but listening to the context of the moment. So like this happened, and for anyone familiar with like charitable work or nonprofit work, you often get trapped in these cycles of funding where, you know, you have a project proposed and then you have to do it. And then both fortunately and unfortunately, we started this without full funding. So we had a lot of freedom to listen to the context. So it wasn't a fully fledged project before we began. So this was early days of the pandemic, again, like June 2020. Already that sense of isolation was quite strong. And then of course, people were still really, it was still the murder of George Floyd was still quite fresh, and people were still reeling from the current police brutality and, you know, coming together for racial uprisings. So listening to both that context and then the needs of the participants, we co-created these goals. One was to build creative confidence. So knowing that we're going to be creative together, and there's all kinds of sort of stuff that stops us from showing up in that way. And also that just acknowledging the importance of creativity to imagine otherwise in this moment. Voice important messages or truths to the world, so that we can't build creatively without centering in the truth. And the moment really called for this. And then, of course, feel connected, because we were all sort of starting to feel that creeping sense of isolation, or and for some folks already live there. And so we began with invitation to folks involved to become involved in the project. And I won't spend too much time here. There's a whole video that I'll paste into the chat that's like a half hour explanation of this process and all the various roles. But suffice it to say that there were many components and many people involved. There were art buddies who were leading art workshops. There was the lead artist, Melanie. We had an artist witness that I'll talk about in a little bit. There was our Art Not Shame team that was doing sort of the like buying of supplies and shipping them to participants and all the coordinating in the background. We had three folks come to us through the Guelph Black Heritage Society. And this again was like a very responsive process, like invitation, a response back saying, can't do that, but this is what we need. And so let's form a role around that. And then knowledge holders who sort of framed the whole event and started or process, sharing their knowledge and lived experience to kind of guide people in their own storytelling. And then of course the participants who are at the center of this. And I did not intentionally make this look like a COVID virus, but maybe this was a really creative way that we came to respond to the moment. But so these were the people involved. And all of these roles, I would say, were formed as a result of deep listening. I'm gonna go a little bit faster. So through a series of like over many weeks, we had workshops, we had dialogue, participants submitted sketches, they submitted survey responses. The lead, Melanie, came up with this in this final sketch of what the mural would look like. So this is a digital sketch, and this went through many iterations. Many people's hands were involved in creating this. And from here, she then somehow brilliantly broke it up into what was sort of like a paint by numbers, so that participants could select their individual section that they wanted to animate with their story. So I'll hold that for a second before we see the final result. And this is really where the storytelling component kind of came in most explicitly. So participants were able to pick a section that was then aligned with a color palette. And you can see there's all these examples. They're hard to see up close, but I can, if you go to our website, you can see them in more detail. But that each of these contributions were their own story in their own right. And there are 50 or 60 of these. Here's another example of one like that formed the eye for the main portrait. For the sake of time, I won't read these quotes, but you can, we have them all, so you can actually just go through them yourself. And so what started, this was, even to get to this point was quite a process, but what started as this then was transformed into this. And so we professionally photographed all of the pieces, and then Melanie masterfully stitched it together in Photoshop and created this incredible archive, really, of the stories that were part of this process and this imagining. I'll just take another couple minutes briefly to talk about this really unique role that came up in the process. We had contacted, I was attending a talk by Joni Narita, and she was talking about the role of art in activism and social change. And I just had this like, yeah, Joni's got to be involved, this gut feeling. And I gave Joni a call and asked if she wanted to be part of the project. And she somehow in our conversation, in the conversation with Melanie, they came up with the idea of Joni being an artist witness. And so, sorry, before I forget, I'm going to just share Joni's, because you have to check out Joni's work. You can check out her website, but basically her role was to witness what was happening and to create in response. And I thought that's such a unique it's we continue to use this role of the artist witness as a way of archiving, as a way of exchange, as a way of like sort of demonstrating that relation. And out of this, she made, I think, 5 songs, which was incredible. So Where You Make It was one of them. She writes, "I think of this as a musical meditation. It's an instrumental I created with vibey delay on my electric guitar. I was thinking about how the pandemic has kept so many people away from their loved ones, whether because of travel restrictions or because of, say, a family member whose health is vulnerable." I want to play you all of hers, but I know for time we can't. So I'll just maybe focus. Maybe we'll play Remake. I'll play Remake. So Remake, so she writes, "As I read through the answers to the questions we all filled out at the beginning of the process, I made notes on things and phrases that stood out for me. One such phrase was that society needed a remake. This title helped inspire me to write a song about what things could, should be remade. It's about resilience and building anew." And so the other thing to note is that Joni also compiled this video backdrop, which was like some of the submissions from participants, some of the words that they sent in, some of the videos they took of themselves. So you get a kind of snapshot into the back end of how this all looked.
"We've heard it said before, well now it's coming in spades. And if you weren't quite sure, things will never be the same. Is this our chance for redemption? A call to build with intention.
So a really incredible process of kind of constant listening, witnessing, storytelling, and letting that inform and shape the project as we go.
Many, many, many thanks, Michelle. What a lovely narrative you have provided us this evening in understanding the journey of this. And it's a rather extraordinary journey. The one idea that, of course, you've left with us is the music and the concept of remake. Shane, you have an interesting thought, I think, relative to the experience that the project took people through as it pertains to mental health and the whole concept of shame. I'm going to ask you to maybe explore that a little bit, if you don't mind, with Michelle and see what we can learn.
Michelle, one of the affects that I consider a lot is shame itself and stigma, being the mechanism to levy shame on bodies, right? And in my discipline of medicine, my other one, I think it's pretty widely recognized that shame is not exclusively, but almost exclusively a deleterious to mental health. It's negative. There's lots of ways to approach shame in medicine, but one of the things that's been done a lot is shame-based parenting, because that tends to stick throughout the life cycle. It's very damaging. But I'm really interested in your project, not only as a destigmatizing thing, of course, but because one of the things that we do with shame is we try and hide. We not only hide having the affect, but we hide the reasons for it, you know, the reason why we might feel shameful. And so I'm wondering how you encourage people to engage with that feeling.
That's an amazing question. I think we're still figuring that out, to be honest. I think one thing that we do in all of our projects, especially because we work pretty closely with like organizations like the Canadian Mental Health Association, where sometimes there are some complex challenges happening for folks, is we have a support person, whether that's a peer support person or a somewhat more clinical support person. But we also, and I say this with no disrespect at all to mainstream mental health, but we also adapt that role according to the community and their needs. Like that role in and of itself might not always be safe for the community that we're engaging with. So that's one piece. Like there's always someone who is there to if someone needs a little bit of extra support, because bringing, I don't know if this is part of what you're getting to, but like bringing shame up in order to destigmatize it can sometimes, well, a lot of times be really difficult, and bring people places that they may not be ready to go. So one is to have extra support available always and referrals on hand. And the other way that we try and like just start with the shame-free container is that in our workshops, we try so hard to create a space that is not like reinforcing like compulsory ableism. That's like everyone is okay and everyone has no needs. And so from the very outset, we ask people, and this we didn't make this up, like we've learned this from other really amazing facilitators, but is like, what do you need to be here? And what do you bring? And what you need to be here right now in this moment isn't what you need to fix your whole life, quote unquote. It's what do you need right here, right now? Knowing that changes, sometimes moment to moment, and knowing that everybody has something, like everybody has needs, or they might say my needs are being met in this moment, but then also inviting like, what do you bring? And I cannot tell you, like sometimes the power of that opening circle like brings me to tears, because it's just, you watch community negotiating with and for one another, sometimes conflicting needs, like sometimes someone needs you to speak louder and someone else might be triggered by loud speaking. And so watching like creative problem solving happen at the get-go, that is not, so it's not just about like individualized care, it's like, how do we do this together? But then also seeing how people's gifts match, like what other people might need. Like I'm a really great listener and I can hold space for someone, or I've been trained in active listening and I could hold space for someone. Like it's not perfect. Like, don't get me wrong. It's challenging work, because trauma is unpredictable and it can come out in all kinds of ways. And we have to be really responsible about how we invite that into the space. But it's something we think deeply about and train and, you know, and are constantly revisiting, like, how do we do this in a way that sort of takes away the power of shame, like sort of, and I think that's where, you know, you talk, make it possible for people to talk about complex issues while also encouraging boundaries too. Like, you know, if we're going to invite a conversation around something that's really challenging and it's with a particular demographic, like it's with a group of young people with complex mental health issues, we have to be careful of our line there, but also trust that people can also hold it. And that's a tricky thing. I say that with caution, like, yeah. Or like, you know, when we invite something, it's like, you're going to think about a challenge, because we also in programs, like we have this program called Fuck Perfect and we try and go into creative risk, but, you know, we have encouraged people to like check in, around their own consent. So one, it's like, if we're going to ask people something, we're like, think of a challenge in your life. Don't go here. Maybe go here. Something that's significant enough, but that is something you can hold in this space. And also, I think a practice that we hold really, really deeply is like valuing a no as much as a yes. Like, what does a no make possible in a space for both that person and other people, and setting up the space that way, so that consent is always, always forefront and everything we do is invitational. And I say that knowing that you can say that and still put pressure on a group to, you know, expose certain things. So you have to really live into that practice. Yeah, I could go on and on, but it's an excellent question. And it's like, I think something we'll be wrestling with forever in this work. Did that answer your question?
Yeah. I mean, that's a beautiful procedural answer, you know?
Thanks very much, Michelle. And thank you for the question, Shane. We're interested, I think, in learning from you how you perceive story or narrative as affecting people's sense of isolation and or community, landing on the community word, which is front and center tonight.
Experiences in creative ways. And I like for those places to be congenial and welcoming and trauma-informed. But the reality is, you know, publishing something leaves one exposed and vulnerable and open to an amazing contemporary amount of horrible commentary, possibly. So it's a tricky issue, especially if one's publishing online. But I think that if it's done well and sensitively, oftentimes, and the motivations are, you know, centered and aligned with, I don't know, for lack of a better word, the force or something. I think that the net effect is positive and good, and that the writing will do some sort of obscure, non-linear good in the world. I think so. And definitely in my little of mental health and disability and non-neurotypicality, people tend to say in those various projects that I have that they feel like community is being built. And I gotta say, if there ever was a experiment to attest to the power of narrative building community, Sina definitely has invested in that project and has had great success, including tonight, I hope, but also Hamilton Arts and Letters. It's a CPAS, and it's still going strong. The end.
Outstanding, and thank you. Michelle, did you want to add a couple of thoughts there?
Just briefly, it just made me think of a moment in one of our Fuck Perfect workshops where we were like kind of reflecting on the act of creation. And we were just like, we are also like, we start the workshop kind of responding to culture and story and representation, like things that feel imposed on us. And then we move through it by creating culture. And I think story would fall in line with culture. Mm-hmm. And I think that's just really powerful work, and I think helps me, certainly, I won't speak for participants, move from feeling like stories are being done to me to I am the creator of a story and the creator of culture that can be something different. if that makes sense. A little less shame-based, hopefully.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like a good place to be, a little less shame-based, for sure. So are there any last thoughts that you'd leave us with, Shane and Michelle?
Be kind is all I got. Two words.
We'll remember that. It's easy to remember it, but it's to act it, A and B it. Yeah, thank you. Michelle?
No, nothing in particular. Just thank you for having us.
Oh, the thanks happened to reside with us to be able to say this really is our first foray into this kind of experience. This has been an extraordinary one. I speak personally, but I'm sure I speak on behalf of individuals who have come to join us this evening. So thanks to each of you, Shane and Michelle, to Lorraine and Daniel for working with Jennifer and me to bring this to life on this October evening. And Michelle, we do a lot of work with a program called Caregiving Essentials through McMaster Continuing Education. And during this COVID window of time, we have realized how essential community is to individuals who are actively caring for a loved one in these extraordinary times. So some nice connections there to your work as well. So thanks again, everybody. Have a great rest of the evening, and we look forward to seeing you again.